The American Land Question. Joseph R. Stromberg, 2009. In 1934, in the depths of the Great Depression, Southern agrarian and historian Frank Owsley called for an American land reform. He suggested that unemployed or underemployed families be staked to a homestead, even subsidized to remain on the land and produce. Footnote: Owsley, as paraphrased by Clyde N. Wilson in Defending Dixie, Essays in Southern History and Culture, Columbia, South Carolina, Foundation for American Education, 2006, page 337. This proposal was not really all that shocking. Such a program would have been consistent enough with the advertised purpose of certain phases of American land policy from 1776 on. American governments handed out land, however acquired, for over a century to veterans, settlers, land speculators, railroads, timber corporations, mining companies, and other parties. I'll give you three guesses which groups made out the best. Governments did so as a source of revenue, for geostrategic reasons, to win favor with voters, or to reward a small class of typically American operators who flat out deserve to be rich. In a new revolutionary and republican society, there was of course much talk about widespread property as the bulwark of republican freedom. But the talk was so general that Federalists and Republicans could share it while leaving themselves plenty of room in which to create a small class of owners of a disproportionate amount of the public domain. Overall, from the founding land speculators down to 1893, when the frontier allegedly ran out, American land policy resembled in both theory and practice the kind of privatization we see under mercantilist Republican administrations. One landmark in the process was Johnson and Graham's lessee versus William McIntosh, 1823. Here, Chief Justice John Marshall undertook to write a long essay on the received theory of how property previously stolen by European kings or their agents is best conveyed. As was his wont, Marshall proved entirely too much in as clear a case of Albert J. Knox's copper riveting of narrowly focused property rights as we could want. Footnote: for international law and property stolen overseas, see Anthony Ange, Finding the Peripheries, Sovereignty and Colonialism in 19th Century International Law, Harvard International Law Journal, 40, Winter 1999, pages 1 to 71. On Indian title, see Carl Wattner, Libertarians and Indians, Proprietary Justice and Aboriginal Land Rights. Journal of Libertarian Studies, 7, Spring 1983, pages 147 to 156. Ronald Takaki, Iron Cages, Race and Culture in 19th Century America, New York, OUP 1990, 1979, Chapter 4, Beyond Primitive Accumulation. Joseph R. Stromberg, Albert J. Nock and Alternative History, The Freeman Ideas on Liberty, 58.9, November 2008, pages 32-38. Southern agrarian Andrew Little noted that from the settler's point of view, the whole frontier process represented an attempt to get away from would-be aristocrats and other aspiring land monopolists. Consistent Republican ideologists like Thomas Skidmore and George H. Evans agitated from the 1820s into the 1840s in favor of giving homesteaders first claim on the territories. Generally speaking, other claimants prevailed, while the politics of slavery and anti-slavery further complicated the matter. In the bigger picture, the Homestead Act of 1862 was the exception rather than the rule, as Paul W. Gates showed in a noteworthy 1936 paper. Footnote: Andrew Little, The Backwoods Progression, From Eden to Babylon, The Social and Political Essays of Andrew Nelson Little, edited by M. E. Bradford, Washington, D.C., Gateway Regnery, 1990, pages 77-94. On Skidmore and Evans, see William Appleman Williams, The Roots of the Modern American Empire, New York, Random, 1969, page 75. Paul W. Gates, The Homestead Law in an Incongruous Land System, American Historical Review, 41, July 1936, pages 652-681. Roy M. Robbins, Our Landed Heritage, Lincoln, University of Nebraska Press, 1942. Arthur A. Eckrich, Jr., The Decline of American Liberalism, New York, Athenaeum, 1969, Chapter 10, Preemption, Exploitation, Progress. I cannot discuss here what an ideal policy based on mixing one's labor with resources might have looked like. Suffice it to say that sales of thousands and tens of thousands of acres to individuals, land companies, and corporations were not especially consistent with any genuine Republican ideal. The disappearance of most of the best land in California into the hands of a half dozen individuals in a few decades comes to mind. Footnote: Stuart H. Holbrook, The Age of the Moguls, Garden City, New York, Doubleday, 1954, pages 118 to 128. But large-scale buyers had mixed their money with federal land officers, and that no doubt counts for something. Meanwhile, the judiciary, state and federal, busily remodeled the common law and shifted the burdens of industrialization onto third parties, extensively modifying the older law of nuisance. Harry Scheiber finds that law was often, if not to say usually, mobilized to provide effective subsidies and immunities to heavily capitalized special interests under either instrumentalist or formalist doctrine. Even existing doctrines of public rights and eminent domain came to serve business interests. Finally, federal judges' discovery in the 1880s of corporate personhood in the 14th Amendment perfected the Federalist Party's original mercantilist program. Footnote: Harry N. Scheiber, Regulation, Property Rights, and Definition of the Market, Law and the American Economy. Journal of Economic History, 41, March 1981, pages 103 to 109. On corporate personhood, see Walter Prescott Webb, Divided We Stand, The Crisis of a Frontierless Democracy, Westport, Connecticut, Hyperion, 1985, 1944, pages 32 to 48. All these changes importantly influenced just who would benefit from the American state system of land tenure, to use Knox's phrase, and its attendant modes of preemption and exploitation. Land and independence. Many writers have seen a special relationship between land ownership and personal independence. And here we hit on what is perhaps the truest insight of Republican theory, one taken up by many classical liberals. Briefly, this holds that a broad middle class of property owners is essential to the maintenance of free societies. The point is as old as Aristotle. On the negative side, in decrying the social effects of England's fabled land monopoly, radical liberals like Percy Bysshe Shelley, Thomas Paine, Thomas Hodgkin, and John Bright implicitly affirmed the Republican axiom. A typical 19th century American self-help book aimed at young men did not say, get a job working for wages within an increasingly intricate division of labor so as to enjoy a greater variety of consumer goods. Instead, it said, get yourself a competency, a vision fraught with Republican implications suitably modernized. Working for wages, if one did it at all, was a temporary stage to be endured while learning a skill or trade, and abandoned later in favor of real or potential independence. This independence, derided in our time as illusory, left one free within limits, not just from state interference, but also from 19th century employers. And if independence is illusory in our time, it is at least partly because the political activities of well-connected elites long since removed the preconditions of independence deliberately and systematically. One key, but not the only one, to this much sought-after independence was access to land, a theme taken up by Catholic writers Hilaire Belloc and G.K. Chesterton in early 20th century England. Sociologist Robert Nisbet commented that never, after reading Belloc, did he imagine that there could be genuine individual liberty apart from individual ownership of property. In any case, as historian Christopher Lash put it, Americans took it as axiomatic that freedom had to rest on the broad distribution of property ownership. Footnote: Robert Nisbet, Introduction, The Servile State, by Hilaire Belloc, Indianapolis, Liberty Fund, 1977, page 14. Christopher Lash, The True and Only Heaven, New York, Norton, 1991, page 204. Perhaps Americans were wrong to believe such a thing, but let us examine the matter a bit more. This American axiom receives support from those political economists who believe that the land-labor ratio importantly determines social structure. Edward Gibbon Wakefield somewhat gave the game away in the 1830s by opposing easy access to land in Australia, lest potential wage earners try for self-sufficiency before spending enough years working for others. Marx chided Wakefield for letting this bourgeois secret out, and was in turn chided by Franz Oppenheimer, Achille Lauria, and Nock for not learning the right lesson from Wakefield's recommendations on rigging the market. Footnote: Karl Marx, Capital, New York International, 1967, 1887, 1, Chapter 33, The Modern Theory of Colonization. Franz Oppenheimer, A Postmortem on Cambridge Economics, American Journal of Economics and Sociology, 3, October 1943, pages 121 to 122. Franz Oppenheimer, The Gospel of Freedom, American Journal of Economics and Sociology, 7, April 1948, page 363. H.J. Nibor argued, 1900, that where resources are open, few will work for big enterprises, and the latter will, if they can, institute some form of slavery. Evzy Domar writes, 1970, that one never finds free land, free peasants, and non-working owners together. Why? Because where political leverage allows, aspiring lords and literal rent-seekers will eliminate the free land, the free peasants, or both. Footnote: H.J. Nibor, Slavery as an Industrial System, The Hague, Niehoff, 1900, pages 387 to 391. Evzy D. Domar, The Causes of Slavery and Serfdom, A Hypothesis, Journal of Economic History, 30, March 1970, pages 18 to 32. Colonial Policies. With this theorem in view, let us survey some colonial evidence. Enterprisers in colonies have always wanted regular supplies of cheap labor for their projects. Although there is no evidence in favor of a right to such thing, these prospective employers were never discouraged. Aided by colonial administrators with the same assumptions, they gradually overcame native economic independence. Land was the key, and neither the colonizers nor the natives doubted it. No matter how hard natives worked on their holdings, colonialists decried their idleness and their uncivilized failure to work for wages. We may therefore give the overworked English enclosures time off for now and look at some other cases. Footnote: But see William Lazenick, Karl Marx and Enclosures in England, Review of Radical Political Economics, 6, 1974, pages 1 to 59. Consider the Japanese colonial administrator in Okinawa, who complained in 1899 that the typical Okinawan held land and therefore had low expenses and few wants. For these reasons, the native saw no need to undertake any other business, nor to save money. Since native lands were held informally, they could not be capitalized. Such people and properties did little for the great cause of development, and shortly the Japanese government denounced Okinawan's customary arrangements as feudal and set out to modernize the island. American occupation later perfected this anti-agrarian revolution. Footnote: Mark Selden, Okinawa and American Security Imperialism, Remaking Asia, Essays on the American Uses of Power, edited by Selden, New York, Pantheon, 1974, pages 279 to 302. Doubtless, however, much employment was created in the post-World War II Okinawan service economy dominated by the U.S. military. Turning to English colonies in the Caribbean and Africa, we find comparable phenomena. England abolished slavery in the colonies in the 1830s, never mind that, as historian Eric Foner comments, through a regressive tax system the British working classes paid the bill for abolition. By this time, English policymakers had embraced Adam Smith's view that positive incentives motivated labor better than fear of starvation or draconian punishments did. But an ocean made all the difference, Foner observes, and new peasantries made up of former slaves were seen in London, as in the Caribbean, as a threat not simply to the economic well-being of the islands, but to civilization itself. John Stuart Mill's famous defense of peasant proprietors did not extend to the blacks of the Caribbean. Their desire to escape plantation labor and acquire land was perceived as incorrigible idleness. Footnote: Eric Foner, Nothing But Freedom, Emancipation, and Its Legacy. Baton Rouge, Louisiana, Louisiana State University Press, 1983, pages 14, 28, and 30. This last point has been misunderstood. It is quite separate from Mill's well-documented defense of the rights of black Jamaicans as subjects of the crown after the colonial governor Edward Eyre visited savage reprisal on alleged rebels in 1865. Mill did not, however, defend the rights of blacks in the colonies as a class of free peasant farmers. He expected them to work for wages or, at best, set themselves up as petty shopkeepers. Footnote. See Bart Schultz, Mill and Sidgwick, Imperialism and Racism. Utilitas, 19-2007, pages 127-128, as well as the sources cited by Foner on the point, H.J. Perkin, Land Reform and Class Conflict in Victorian Britain, The Victorians and Social Protest, edited by J. Butt and I.F. Clark, Hamden, Connecticut, Archon, 1973, pages 177-217, and Clive J. Dewey, The Rehabilitation of the Peasant Proprietor in 19th Century Economic Thought, History of Political Economy, 6, 1974, pages 17-47. On Mill's defense of black Jamaicans' legal rights, see Bernard Semmel, Democracy vs. Empire, The Jamaica Riots of 1865, and the Governor Eyre Controversy, Garden City, New York, Anchor, 1969. And so Britain's former slave colonies put vagrancy and other laws to work, and crafted taxes aimed at restricting the freedmen's access to land. As Foner puts it, taxation has always been the state's weapon of last resort in the effort to promote market relations within peasant societies, that is, to force people into markets in which they were not eager to participate. In Kenya, the problem was one of dispossessing a peasantry with a pre-existing stake in the soil, but colonial legislation proved up to the task. Foner concludes that in Britain's Caribbean and African colonies, the free market was conspicuous by its absence, its workings restricted as far as possible in the interest of the well-off and powerful. Footnote. Foner, page 25, 31-32, and 37. Historian Colin Bundy has studied the economic rise and political economic fall of a class of independent African farmers in the Eastern Cape Colony and other parts of South Africa. Various Cape Location Acts, 1869, 1876, and 1884, sought to lessen the number of idle squatters, i.e. rent-paying tenants economically active on their own behalf, on white-owned lands. Such peasant farming conferred a degree of economic independence, an ability to withhold, if he so preferred, his labor from white landowners or other employers. Further, both the farmer and the mine owner perceived the need to apply extra economic pressures to break down the peasant's independence, increase his wants, and to induce him to part more abundantly with his labor, but at no increased price. In their view, Africans had no right to continue as self-sufficient and independent farmers if this conflicted with white interests. Footnote. Colin Bundy, The Rise and Fall of South African Peasantry. London, Heinemann, 1979, pages 78, 91, and 115. Bundy observes that social engineering on this scale took time and effort, but the incentives were powerful. By way of a one-man, one-lot rule under the Glenn Gray Act of 1894, legislators sought to keep African farming within certain acceptable bounds. Here, finally, was a use for John Locke's famous proviso about leaving enough resources for others. Evictions increased after the Anglo-Boer War, 1899-1903. Rents rose, enclosure defenders take note, and former tenants stayed on as laborers. Tax pressure on African farmers increased. This employers' offensive from 1890 to 1913 ended successfully in the South African Natives Land Act of 1913, which effectively outlawed the practices under which a particular African peasantry had shown much success. Footnote. Bundy, pages 134-135, 137. One supposes, in standard libertarian fashion, that agricultural employment increased thereafter along with land values, but that was the whole point, to proletarianize independent peasants by leaving them no option but to work for wages for Boers and Brits on farms, in mines, and elsewhere. Whether more employment was good in itself seems unclear. we can at least impute the outcome back to specific political intentions and levers. So much for the colonies, then, and all this without even mentioning the two greatest monuments to England's defense of free markets, Ireland and India. Telescopic land reform. Colonial bureaucrats and employers saw a definite connection between small-scale land ownership and independence and resolved to cut that independence short. By now, we begin to see that the subsidy of history, to use Kevin Carson's useful term, has been very large indeed. Footnote: Kevin Carson, The Subsidy of History, The Freeman Ideas on Liberty, 58.5, June 2008, pages 33 to 38. A number of libertarians have understood the problem at hand in pretty much these terms. They have tended, however, to dwell on instances far away from our own shores, writing about land reform in Latin America, South Africa, Asia, and other places. In the mid-1970s, Murray Rothbard, Roy Childs, and others addressed the matter. Rothbard wrote that free market economists go to Asia and Latin America and urge the people to adopt the free market and private property rights while ignoring the suppression of the genuine private property of the peasants by the exactions of quasi-feudal landlords. In this vacuum, only the local communists appeared to support the peasants' struggle for their property, and so libertarians allowed themselves to become supporters of feudal landlords and land monopolists in the name of private property. Footnote: Murray Rothbard, Justice and Property Right, Innovator, January 1965, pages 10 to 11. Decades earlier, that very conservative German liberal economist Wilhelm Röpke wrote that German history would have gone better had Prussia undergone a radical agrarian reform, breaking up the great estates and putting peasant farms in their place. He adds, influential social democratic leaders opposed the transformation of the great estates in Prussia into peasant holdings as a retrograde step. Röpke called for freeing Germany from agrarian and industrial feudalism and the ills of proletarization, of concentration and over-organization of the agglomeration of individual power and the destruction of the individuality of labor. In his view, the typical proletarianized worker or clerk wanted a small house of his own with a garden and a goat shed, an undisturbed family life without training courses, mass meetings, processions, and political flag days, dignity and pleasure in his work, an independent, if modest, existence. Footnote: Wilhelm Röpke, The Solution of the German Problem, New York, Putnam's, 1946, pages 184, 186, and 203 to 204. Why go abroad? For enclosure-like pressures on small holders closer to home, we need look no farther than states like Kentucky, where courts vigorously enforced the full feudal rigor of the broad-form deed, thereby ensuring the strip mining of many a mountaineer out of productive existence down to the early 1990s. Footnote: James Branscombe, Paradise Lost, Southern Exposure, Summer to Fall, 1973, pages 29 to 41, and John Gaventa, In Appalachia, Property is Theft, Southern Exposure, Summer to Fall, 1973, pages 42 to 52. With the system so long stacked in favor of big landholders and bankers, well subsidized by history, one begins to understand the popularity of those New Deal programs that promoted individual home ownership. Economist Michael Perlman has confirmed a direct relationship between rural labor without independent means of support and the applied politics of English classical economists. Footnote: Michael Perlman, The Invention of Capitalism, Classical Political Economy and the Secret History of Primitive Accumulation. Duke, North Carolina, Duke University Press, 2000, pages 1 through 12, Introduction, Dark Designs. The latter preached a great gospel of work, mainly for others who ought to be doing this work. Except for a narrowing class of dissenting Protestant factory owners, those most vigorously espousing this gospel were not themselves noted for doing a lot of work. Together, however, owners and economists said in effect, "Work for us, join the armed forces, or emigrate, ye doughty Angles, Saxons, Jutes, and Scots." And emigrate they did, leaving us with an American folk wisdom in which old times in England, Scotland, and Ireland were not that great. This folk memory may have at least as much heuristic value as latter-day econometric claims that everyone became better off in the new division of labor. And so we return to Henry George's problem. How did Americans manage as a society to seize so much land, incur whatever moral guilt goes with the seizures, and then not bloody have any of it? The chief mechanism was precisely the political means to wealth that Oppenheimer and Nock analyzed. Footnote. See Stromberg, Nock. The reason the phrase robber barons struck the right note is that there were such individuals. California was a laboratory case, as George well knew, of the successful primitive accumulation of land by a microscopically small class of state-made men. As with ontogeny and phylogeny, Western accumulation recapitulated Eastern accumulation. From such causes arose the famous end of the frontier circa 1893, but open land did not so much disappear naturally as succumb to preemption. And then, with perfect timing, the conservation movement put enormous quantities of land beyond the reach of actual settlers. As for those Americans who currently own property, they typically own it after 20 or more years of bank payments. Is land so genuinely scarce that a bank must always be in the middle? This remains our central question. Certainly, 19th century allocations played a lasting role, and later political interventions added to concentrated property ownership. And what of the promotion of easy home ownership in recent years? Is it the product of, 1, the widespread delusion in the wake of Lyndon Johnson's and Richard Nixon's inflationary financing of the Vietnam War that real estate constitutes the ultimate inflation hedge, and 2, the specific dynamics of the expansionist fractional reserve banking under new rules, deregulation, increasing moral hazards for bankers? There is also the unhappy fact of property taxes, our chief surviving feudal due. Fail to pay those, and the state enrolls a new owner on your former property. This reduces somewhat the fact of private property and land. Independence, republicanism, and liberty. Some classical liberals and libertarians downgrade personal independence. Better to participate in the going order and enjoy a wider array of comforts, they say. But socialists and corporate liberals can play the same game, and have for over a century. It seems to me that those libertarians who join in this refrain rather willfully misconstrue a very simple point. They hail the joys of the division of labor, the higher degree of civilization, that is, more stuff, to be gained from dependence, interdependence, and sundry trickles of income and utility down and up. But already in 1936, Southern agrarian John Crow Ransom noticed a flaw in this reasoning, writing, "Income is not enough, and the distribution of income is not enough. If those blessings sufficed, we might as well come to collectivism at once, for that is probably the quickest way to get them." Footnote, John Crow Ransom, The South is a Bulwark, 1936, in Jack Salzman and Barry Wallenstein editors, Year of Protest. New York, Pegasus, 1967, page 268. If greater choice among consumer goods makes up for lost independence, then the case for socialism, or X, would be clinched, provided socialism, or X, could deliver the economic goods, where X stands for any political ideology offering us the same stuff-independence trade-off. I doubt we are necessarily better off merely because of employment. We need to know more, including why particular sets of choices exist in the first place. Back in the 60s, selective service used to channel us into the right occupations by threatening to draft us. Given the parameters, our choices were free. If it's that easy, then we are always free, no matter what the historical and institutional constraints. Similarly, to hell or cannot was a choice, and never mind that Oliver Cromwell and his army arbitrarily created this particular prisoner's dilemma. But perhaps I have leapt from choices among goods to choices between ways of life. Why? Let us look into this. What if proletarianization is not the ideal form of human life? What if a complex division of labor is merely useful or convenient, but not a moral imperative? What if most of us are hirelings, well-paid or otherwise, and then we learn what that status amounts to? The post-Marxist socialist André Gorz writes, "Capitalism owes its political stability to the fact that, in return for the dispossession and growing constraints experienced at work, individuals enjoy the possibility of building an apparently growing sphere of individual autonomy outside of work." Footnote: André Gorz, Farewell to the Working Class, Boston, South End, 1982, page 80. Our interest here is the autonomy mentioned, which sounds like a near cousin of independence. The sentiment seems sound enough, and the partial convergence of Röpke and Gorz is eye-opening. Now, in the view of Quentin Skinner, a modern Republican theorist of note, unfreedom arises both from direct forcible coercion and from institutional arrangements that make people dependent, since the latter always contain the possibility, realized or not, of arbitrary interference and coercion. Such discussions usually center on the form of state. Utilitarian liberals like Henry Sidgwick did not care about forms. If the Sublime Porte, Tsar, or King of England leaves us substantially alone, we are free, and that is that. In Skinner's view, if these worthies can on their own motion change their policy of leaving us alone, we are not free, no matter what they are doing right now. Freedom requires that we not be menaced by latent unknown powers. Footnote: Quentin Skinner, Liberty Before Liberalism, Cambridge, UK, CUP, 1998, pages 68 to 72, 96 to 99. Freedom in this sense is liberty, a shared civic or public good. Like many real public goods, it is not provided by the state. Indeed, the state may be its chief enemy. Law and settled custom may provide this public good, and consumer goods, the people's pottage, do not compensate for abandoning such an order where it exists. Today, people often work long hours to buy some independence. In another time, they began with some independence and then chose how hard to work. Now we see perhaps the difference between choices among economic goods and past choices between systems structuring our choices. Widespread land ownership long supported a kind of liberal republican independence. Perhaps we should re-examine the nexus and ask ourselves how, in Donald Davidson's words, we let the freehold pass, and whether that was really for the best.